Hello friends, welcome to the EduSet Network. Very good morning to you all. We are again with you with the same topic. This is the third consecutive day, and in the previous session of ours also, that is since 2 days, we are talking about how to prepare balance sheet. And for this, again with us in our studios is Dr. Amarjeet Malhotra. She is Professor and Associate Dean in Ansal University, Gurgaon. I have very few words. In fact, I've would say to say a lot about her. I would only say she has authored about 6 books, as well as she has passed 21 years of experience in the field of academics, both in India and abroad. And since 2 days, she has been continuously giving you deep insight to this very topic, how to prepare balance sheet. So I would like to welcome our guest, Dr. Amarjeet Malhotra. Ma'am, welcome to the EduSet lecture of ours. And I would like you to tell us, our viewers, more about how to prepare balance sheets.
Sure. Thank you so very much. Good morning, friends. As you know that we have been talking about how to prepare balance sheets in the last 2 days. Basically, we started from the scratch. If you remember, we talked about what is business, why do we need to have, you know, system of accounting in place for in any organization. We talked about in detail the concepts and conventions which are applicable for writing the books of accounts. And in the last day, yesterday afternoon, we stopped at that we have a summary of account balances in the trial balance, and we have 3 types of accounts, out of which nominal accounts are transferred to profit and loss account, and only 1 type of real account, that is goods account, is transferred to the income statement or profit and loss account, and rest of the accounts balances are transferred to balance sheet. So today we will be targeting in detail how the items are placed in income statement and balance sheet, and what are the specific treatments to specific items. And then lastly, we will talk about the adjustment entries, that is, you know, certain items which are left somehow during the course of the writing the books, how to treat them, how to handle them, right? So this is the agenda for the day, and this is the last lecture. We will be talking about preparation of balance sheet, and in future we may take up lectures on how to analyze balance sheet and income statement, that is financial statements. So to begin with, kindly refer to or recall the last day discussion that in total we have 3 types of accounts, which is nominal, personal and real account. Nominal accounts are transferred to profit and loss account or trading account, depending upon where we have to transfer them. And only 1 type of real account, that is goods, comprising both purchases and sales, are transferred again to trading and profit and loss account. And remaining the accounts, whether in real head or in personal accounts, they all are transferred to balance sheet, right? We talked about the criteria to decide which account to be transferred where. That has already been discussed. Now, I will like to talk about, to begin with, that how do we make trading and profit and loss account? In the trading and profit and loss account, the first section is, actually it has 2 sections. We may call it as income statement. As I'm saying, trading and profit and loss account, we are using and two time. So first part of this account is known as trading account, and the second part of this account is known as profit and loss account. So it means the result of trading of goods or services is been shown in the first section, and the result of, you know, dealing with administrative expenses and net profits, etc., is shown in the second section of this account. So basically, this is one account having 2 sections, right? So we debit the trading account with opening stock, with net purchases, whatever net purchases means, the purchases minus any returns. So for example, we have purchased raw material for 10,000 crores. Out of which 100 crores have been, you know, returned. The worth of raw material which has been returned is 100 crores. So out of 10,000, we will deduct this 100,000 crores, right? So difference would be your net purchases, which is going to be debited. And apart from these two things, opening stock and purchases, we are going to debit all type of expenses which are of direct nature. We call them as direct expenses. And the question is, what are direct expenses? Direct expenses are those expenses which have been incurred in the course of, you know, producing goods or services, rendering services, or in the course of trading things, without which we cannot actually convert the material into saleable position. Or if we are into trading, we are buying semi-finished goods or even finished goods, we cannot sell off those goods without spending this much amount on them. So that is what is known as direct expense. So direct expense, for example, in case of manufacturing, if you are spending on factory insurance, that is direct expense. If you are spending on factory, you know, any oil, any lubricant to be used in the factory premises or on the plant, even that is direct expenses. You are paying something, you know, for say, for example, insurance of the machineries, plant and machinery, even that is direct expenditure. You are paying something for the rent of the factory, even that is, you know, direct expenditure. So we are going to debit our trading and profit and loss account with all with opening stock, with net purchases, and all direct expenses whatever are given in the situation or in the question, right? Then what is to be credited here? In this section, the first section, that is trading account, we will credit this account with sales value. Again, sales will be net sales. So whatever the value of sales we have during one financial year, that is one accounting year, we are going to deduct the amount of returns out of it, because it's not possible that whatever you are selling is being accepted always. No, there are going to be instances where certain amount of or certain value of the amounts of the goods sold is going to be returned on certain basis. Maybe the material is not liked, maybe it has reached little later than the desired date. So there could be any reason, but the material is being returned. So sales minus sales return is the net sales that is going to be credited along with the closing stock. Closing stock is basically the inventory which is left with us on the last day of the accounting year, either unconsumed or unsold. Both are applicable, right? If I'm saying unconsumed means we purchased it to be used in the production process, but we couldn't consume it. So this is unconsumed. Sorry. And it could be unsold means you produced finished product, you intend to sell them off in the accounting area, but you could not sell it off. So this is unsold. So whether it is unsold or unconsumed, under both the condition, it will be known as your closing inventory, and it is going to be credited in the trading and profit and loss account, the first section, that is trading account. Now the difference of these items which we have debited and the items which we have credited is known your gross profit. So basically this section gives us the answer, what is the amount of gross profit for the business, right? Now this gross profit, this could be gross profit or gross loss. If it is gross profit, it will be taken to the right hand side of this account itself in the second section. If it is your gross loss, it will be taken to the left hand side, that is debit side of the income statement, that is second section of this account, right? So either gross profit or gross loss is available now. Now out of this gross profit or gross loss, we have to further charge few items, few expenses. We have to further credit few incomes as well, revenues as well. Now the question is, what are those items which are going to be debited from the second section of this account, that is a trading and profit and loss account we are referring to. Now in the second section, we will debit it with all expenses which have been incurred for selling, for distribution, for administration, right? If I'm saying for administration, whether you are paying salaries to accounts office, any employee in the accounts office, whether you are spending in the account office for stationery, you may be paying rent for the accounts office, you may be paying rent for the office in general, right? You may be paying salary to the general manager, you may be paying insurance for the building you are using as an office, you may be paying rent for any other building which you are using. For example, even a genset, if it has been used and we are paying for the diesel charges on the generator, even that is an expenditure which is being spent for carrying the business operation for administration purposes, if we are using that genset for office only, right? So even apart from this, you may be spending on selling and distribution things. So what are those selling and distribution items? Say for example, you are paying salaries to the salesman. That is for selling. To encourage, to promote sales, we have hired sales persons. So we are paying salaries to them. So those people are actually accelerating our sales. They are contributing in making the sales out. So those are known precisely as selling and distribution expenses. And the best example for distribution would be, for example, you are getting, you are selling your product by using four wheelers. You are into the actually hardcore selling, direct selling. So the four wheeler is actually insured. The insurance for the four wheelers is your direct expenditure for distribution. You may be paying salary to the driver, even that is an example of distribution expenditure. You may be paying for petrol or diesel, whichever the vehicle is running at. Even that expenditure is your fuel expenditure, is your distribution expenditure. So these are the few examples. You know, since this is a lecture on, you know, screen, but I'm not teaching you on board as such, so I'm trying to give you maximum examples so that you could actually correlate. Right, that's the purpose here, that I'm sharing so many examples. So we have given you examples for almost every head, for selling, for distribution, for administration, for general expenses. So after this, debiting all this expenditure in the second section of this account, now if we have any kind of revenue income, for example, we are having a building which we are not using for the business, and we have let it off to somebody and we are getting rent on it. So that rent received is basically not an income from the business operations. You are getting rent from the building which is not used in the business operation, but that is a revenue for sure. So that is going to be credited in the income statement second section. You are getting some commission, even that is going to be credited. You have gained something out of selling a fixed asset in the business, you know, even that is going to be your revenue for the year. So these are the things which will be credited and debited. Now the difference of total of the debit items and difference of total of credit items will be taken as your net profit, right? So the net profit or net loss is the difference between these two items, right? Now after this, the next thing is I would like to talk about certain items which are somewhat specific, and we have to see that how they are actually treated. So the items are the first example or first important item I would like to take is salaries. Salaries are basically including the share of the employers in the provident fund. Salaries are not excluding the share of employers in the provident fund. If say for example the salary is 20,000 and after paying 12% on 20,000, say for example it will come out 2400. So if we are paying 2400 in the fund, provident fund of the employee, and that salary of the employer employee will be not 20,000, it will be whatever has been actual paid plus whatever the amount is been deposited on behalf of employee in the employer's fund, in the provident fund, even that is going to be debited. So salary will be comprising both the actual payments made to employees plus any contribution made by the employers to the provident fund. Now after this, if there is a tax deducted at source, employers are, you know, as per the guidelines by the government of India, employers are, you know, liable to deduct tax at source from the salaries of the employees to whosoever they have hired. Now this tax is going to be deducted and deposited with the income tax department with government of India. Now if this tax has been, you know, deducted, it is not basically that we are going to reduce the amount of salary payments. No, the salary will be, which is going to be debited, would comprise whatever has been actual paid plus whatever has been deducted as TDS, tax deducted at source, TDS stands for that. So both the total of these two things is going to be debited in P&L account, not after tax salary, you know, because TDS is the liability of the employee, not of the employer. This is a personal liability of the employee who is working in the company, in the business, right? Not of the employer. Employer has a liability to pay tax on the income, on the profit earned by the business, not by the salary or by the income earned by the employees. That becomes his or her personal income, right? And he or she is liable to pay the tax. So it's important that salary which is deducted, which is debited in the P&L account, is comprising the contribution made to employer's provident fund plus any amount of TDS if charged, if employee is under that section, under that, you know, purview. Then next point I would like to talk, if in case there is some charity been made by the employers for the purpose of promotion, for the purpose of social responsibility, or even for some other reason, you know, the charities could be charities could be made in the society, either in a temple, either in a church, or anywhere, or in an NGO, etc., etc. So the question is, how do we treat this charity? So this charity is basically an expenditure to promote the goodwill of the business, so which leads to enhancing the sales. So there is an indirect motive. If it is not there, even then the goodwill is going to be definitely improved for the business. So charities are always debited as an expenditure, if we are making a charity in kind, we will reduce the goods account or the purchases account. If we are making charity in cash, we are going to debit the account, P&L account debit side, by that amount. So this is another item. Now next is, what about LIC premium? In case it has been given that LIC premium is being paid out of the business accounts, so how to deal with that? LIC premium is basically the life insurance premium, or for as matter any other company could be there. If life insurance premium of the owners, of the partners, proprietors has been paid out of the business account, it is not the responsibility of business to pay the life insurance premium of the owners, of the proprietors or partners. It's important to understand. This becomes the drawings. Whatever has been paid for the life insurance premium of the owners becomes the drawing amount, withdrawal by the owners, equivalent to withdrawals, and that is not going to be debited as an expenditure of the business. It's something important to remember, right? So it means this will be taken as drawings, and as per the separate entity concept which we talked in the yesterday, that is going to be liability of owners towards business. This is the application of separate entity concept which we just talked last day. So this is a good example of that concept here. Now how to deal with bonus? There are four times employees are being paid bonus. In India, for example, on festival season, for example, Diwali, Christmas, New Year Eve, bonuses are paid to employees. So how to deal with that amount? This is basically an expenditure to the company only, or to the business, right? Irrespective what for we have made this payment, is this to just to boost up the morale of the employees, or just to motivate them to encourage commitments, etc., etc., whatever could be the reason. But if we are paying them this bonus amount, we are going to debit this in P&L account. Then next is how to deal with the sales tax amount. If sales tax has been given, sales tax has always been paid on sales. It means to promote sales, we are liable to pay taxes to the government, whether the state, it is generally to state government, right? Or it could, something could be to central, irrespective, whomsoever it is payable. So that is going to be taken as an item to be debited in P&L account. It is considered to an expenditure to promote sales. It comes as selling and distribution expenditure. So the next is how to deal in case we have been given some heading as royalty. Royalty could be under two situations. One, we may pay royalty on the basis of production, and we may pay royalty on the basis of sales. So if we are paying royalty to somebody, to some company or to some individual on the basis of number of units produced, then the royalty will be debited in trading account. Mind you, I am saying this will be debited in trading account, not in P&L account, the second section. But if the same royalty, same item is been paid, is been calculated as a percentage or certain amount per item on the basis of sales, how many units we sold, if that is the basis of deciding the amount of royalty, then this royalty will be debited in P&L account, not in your trading account, not in the first section. So this is something important to remember and understand. Then you may find out two items, carriage inwards and carriage outwards. So carriage inwards word stands for the expenditure on, you know, transportation when we bring the raw material in or even the finished goods in. So carriage inward has been spent to bring the material inside the premises, and carriage outwards, as the word say, we are spending on transportation, even ready wala or rickshaw wala or even tempo or whatever, right? But we are spending this amount on such transportation to sell the items off or to send the items out from the premises, out of the premises. So if it is carriage inward, so we have to be very careful when we are making the final account, that whether it is carriage inward or whether it is carriage outward. If it is carriage inward, it will be debited in the first section, that is trading and trading account. And if it is carriage outward, we will be debiting this item in the income statement, second section of the income statement, that is profit and loss account, right? So this need to be remembered. Lastly, I would like to talk about one item, which is octroi. Octroi is basically, you may be, you know, here you would have heard the word chungi or something like that, right? In Hindi we call it as chungi. So this is basically, octroi is something which has been paid to the governments at state levels when we, you know, transit something from one state to another state. So this has been paid basically for on interstate transfer of goods or services, right? So octroi is payable on most of the times it is paid on when we are selling our products, on the finished goods we are selling them off to some other state. But we have to be very careful while reading between the lines. There could be a possibility that you are liable to pay the octroi when somebody from whom you have bought the raw material, and octroi is to be paid by you. There is a condition in the purchase agreement that octroi will be payable by you, right? So it will all depend upon that what was the agreement. So generally octroi is paid on the sold good by the salesperson, by the selling party, and in that case it is going to be debited in the penal account. But there could be very, very rare possibility when there is a liability of the purchaser, right? And if you are purchaser of raw material and you are entitled to pay as per the agreement to pay the octroi, then you will be debiting it in the trading account, the first section of the penal account. But most of the cases it is going to be debited in penal account. If nothing is been given in the question, no detail is been given, simply debit it in the profit and loss account, second section, right? Now I will like to talk about the balance sheet in precise and peculiar way. The balance sheet, as I already mentioned, that is prepared with the help of trial balance. We were talking about items to how to deal while making income statement. Now I will be talking about certain items while making the balance sheet. So we make the balance sheet with the help of, you know, trial balance. As there's as after making the income statement, there's no nominal account left with. So as it has been mentioned, I think two or three times during last 2-3 days, that nominal accounts are, you know, exhausted, are closed while making the income statement. It means no nominal account is left when we are going to make the balance sheet. This is the first thing to be remembered. Now after the nominal accounts are, you know, over, are closed, the next thing is we are left with all personal account and all real type of accounts except for goods account. Right, and apart from that, so these two type of accounts we have with us now. Apart from that, we may have certain newly opened accounts which are the outcome of adjustment entries. Now question is, what are adjustment entries? Give me few minutes, I am going to address this topic in detail, adjustment entries, after few minutes from now, right? So just leaving it here right this moment. Then your debit balances in real account and personal account, they represent assets, as has been discussed, and the credit balances, they represent liability and capital. I hope you remember it from the previous discussion. Now the balance sheet has, there are two important things. We do group the items while making the balance sheet, and we call it as grouping. So what is grouping in making of balance sheet? Grouping means all those items which are of similar nature or characteristic, they are put together under the same head. For example, the head could be given fixed assets, and this fixed asset is a broader head, is a broader group, so that we call it as grouping. And it may have 10 items in it. It may have, you know, furniture, it may have building, it may have land, it may have equipment, it may have plant and so on. So group comprises of what? Items which are fixed nature, right? So this is basically grouping. We may have another group, current assets, having all the assets which are of current nature, which are not having life more than a year. So we may have some other head, investments or so on. In the liability side, again, we may have certain groups, you know. So grouping is basically done with the purpose of improving the interpretation and presentation. Why? Because if we are putting certain items of the similar nature under one head, it helps the users. Whosoever has to use those income statement and balance sheet for their reference purposes, for their personal interest, it will make things easy for them and even for us as a business as well, right? So grouping is always done in a manner that we have similar assets or similar liabilities under one heading, right? Then the second concept or second more variable, another important variable or item which we use while making the balance sheet is marshalling. Now, what is marshalling? Marshalling means deciding the order of putting up assets and liabilities in the balance sheet. So this could be based upon liquidity or based upon the performance. So we call them as marshalling, could be as order of liquidity or as per order of performance. Now, what is order of liquidity and what is order of performance? As I said, marshalling is simply, you know, deciding the order, whether I have to put or show the most liquid asset first and then less liquid asset and then the least liquid asset. You know, these are three words I am using. The most liquid asset, if I am putting it at the first, at the top of the balance sheet in the column asset side, then it means basically I am purposefully deciding that the first asset is the one which is equivalent to cash or cash itself. Most liquid asset is the cash, right? Cash or cash equivalents are considered as liquid assets. So we are basically showing them in first. This is simply discretion. There is no such guideline as such. We can use the order of liquidity or otherwise as well. But if I am using the order of liquidity, means I am showing the most liquid asset. Liquid asset means asset which can be converted into cash or which itself is cash or cash equivalent, right? Then I would be showing the asset which is little less liquid. Little less liquid means, for example, the amount of, debtors. Debtors are my assets. They have to pay me off. So here the debtors could be taken, as somehow at the medium level when it comes to liquidity. The most liquid asset could be, your plant and machinery, your building, your land even for times, because we need some time to sell them off. We are not sure about the price. It keeps on changing, varying, right? So this is known as order of liquidity, but this is not mandatory. As I said, we may show the assets as per the order of, permanence or performance or purpose. So permanence means the most fixed asset which has, which is going to have the maximum life and is more least liquid is going to be shown at the top, at the as a first item, and then in the descending order, less liquid and then the least liquid. So maximum gradually progressing to the most liquid one. So it could be either way, but important thing is, if we are showing assets in the order of permanence or in the order of liquidity, we have to show our liability in the same order. We cannot decide that we will be showing our assets on the basis of, liquidity, but we will be showing our, our liability on the basis of permanence. No, it cannot be done. So as a rule for making the balance sheet, you need to practice this, that you are showing the liabilities as well as assets in the any of the order, but they should be in the same order, whether liquidity or the permanence. So these are the few important points for making the balance sheet. Now the next thing, now I am going to talk about this, that adjustment entries. They are considered to be little difficult when we talk about, teaching. Whenever we have been teaching in the classroom, we always found that students find little bit difficulty in understanding them. So I would like you to pay little more attention while grabbing these concepts now. So adjustment entries, first of all, let's talk about what are adjustment entries. So basically, adjustment entries are those entries which are passed on the last day for those items or transactions in the business which have somehow been ignored or have though been entered are incorrect, right, or are not been recorded completely. So because of this, thing, the outcome is that your profit or loss figure is affected adversely or positively. Either way, your profits are not true and fair. As we talked last day, that we should try to, give a true and very fair picture of the business transaction, business results. But if we have left some item untreated in the books of account, we have ignored to record something, definitely our profit and loss is not a correct figure. You know, it means we are not complying to generally accepted accounting principles. So it becomes very important that if we have by mistake or by chance have ignored something or have recorded something wrong, we need to correct it before making the balance sheet and income statement. So that is what is known as adjustment entry. They are passed at the end of the year. Now there are certain items, and I am going to talk in precise that how to deal with them. First item here I am taking is closing stock. Now the closing stock is, as already talked, that is an inventory which is left unconsumed or unsold. Now this could, there is a possibility that you have been given this closing stock value outside the trial balance. You have already completed the trial balance, right? And outside the trial balance, there is additional information given to you. This info says that this much value of unconsumed stock is there with you, any amount, 1 lakh, 1 crore, 10,000, any amount you can assume. Now, the question is how to deal with this given information. So, closing stock which is given outside the trial balance as additional information, we will be showing it at two places. One, on the credit side of trading account. Whatever the amount is that, we will be crediting the trading account with that amount, and we are going to show this amount in balance sheet under asset side as well. So basically, the point I am making is this, that whatever is given outside the trial balance, any item left unconsumed or partially completed or completed, whatever, that is going to be, shown at two places. Both of the places could be anywhere, right? But it could be debit side, credit side of income statement, or liability side or asset side of the balance sheet. But the items shown out of the trial balance, this lesson need to be remembered, that the items shown outside the trial balance will be shown at two places, not at one place. Unlike if you can actually recall, I said while we started this discussion that whatever is given in the trial balance, either in debit balance or the credit balance, is going to be shown at one place. Do you remember that? We said a nominal account may have any item under that is going to be shown in the income statement or trading account. Asset is going to be shown in the balance sheet only. Liability is going to be shown in the balance sheet only. So the items which are shown in trial balance are shown only at one place, either in trading account or income statement or balance sheet, either side. Whereas items which are given in outside the trial balance as additional info, they are going to be shown at two places. So this is something important to remember. So I think you are clear on how to deal with the closing stock. The second item which I am going to take is outstanding or accrued expenses. Now, what are outstanding or accrued expenses? Let's understand the term first, and then we will talk about then how to deal with them. Now, outstanding or accrued expenses are basically expenditure which has, which was to be paid in the accounting year for which we are making our books, but we somehow have not paid it. We have not paid it. So that expenditure will be known as accrued expenditure or outstanding. It means outstanding means something which you owe to somebody and which against which you have already availed the services. For example, you have availed the services of your employees and you have yet to pay the salary, but you are closing your books on 31st March. For the month of March, your practice is to pay on the next month, 7th of next month. So you have yet to pay the salary of your employees for the month of March. Though you are closing your books, but salary will be paid on 7th April. So the question is, what about the services which have been availed for the month of March? Do we need to pay salaries for that or not? Of course, we do need to pay on 7th April, but we need to, you know, record this salary in our books. Our books are not showing these salaries as expenditure because we have not paid it. So as per accrual concept, it's not important. Important is that I have already availed the services of my employees for the month of March, and while making my books for the month of March, up to month of March, I need to include it as an expenditure. So we will treat that salary for the month of March, which has become due, which need to be paid, which should have been paid, as outstanding salary. Right? If you look at this example which I have just taken, or which we just have shown you, salaries are given as an amount in the trial balance as well. We have extracts of trial balance, and trial balance has one item as salary account, right? Debit side, any amount. And in the additional information, we have been given that salary of 2000, for example, is yet to be paid. So that 2000 will be taken as outstanding expenditure, 10,000 will be taken as already paid for. Now, what is the treatment? The important thing is to understand how to treat 10,000 and how to treat this 2000 while making balance sheet and income statement, that is final accounts. Now, 10,000 will be debited as a salary, as an expenditure, and as a nominal account in the profit and loss account, second section of income statement, right? And this 2000 rupees, which has, you know, which is not been paid, which is just become due, belongs to the accounting period but has yet to be paid, that will be added to the amount 10,000 which has been paid. So basically, your total expenditure against salaries for this accounting period should not be 10,000, it should be 12,000. Why did we do that? Because if we will ignore this 2000, what will be the outcome? The outcome will be this, that my profit will not be fair. My profit will not be correct figure. My profit will be reduced by 2000 because I am showing my expenditure at a lower value, right? Whereas my actual expenditure is 12,000. And if I am ignoring those 2000, I am showing my expenditure 10,000. This means I am showing my profits at a higher rate. So, basic purpose of adjustment entries is to, you know, to show the correct figures of profit and loss and assets and liabilities. So, to give the direct, you know, very fair picture of financial position and operational result, we are passing adjustment entry. So, I hope you are clear on this, that the treatment is, we are going to add the outstanding expenditure. It could be any item. I have taken the example of salaries. It could be rent, it could be any other item, you know, whichever you have yet to pay, but belongs to one accounting period. So that is going to be, you know, debited by adding it to the respective expenditure account. So this is the treatment while treating it in the income statement. Now, as I already said, that any item which is given outside the trial balance is going to be shown at two places. So we have talked about this 2000 which is given outside the trial balance, that one, it will be debited in the trading account also, or in the income statement by adding to the salary account. The question is, what about the second part? As I myself have said that we are going to show it at the two places. Now, the second place will be liability side in the balance sheet. Why? Because this is something which you have yet to pay off. This is your liability. This is the liability of the business to yet to pay this 2000 to the employees, because you have already availed services for that, right? So I hope you are clear that your 2000 is going to be shown at two places, as by adding to the salaries as outstanding salaries and by showing as an outstanding salaries in the liability side of the balance sheet. Now, the next item which I would like to talk about is, you know, prepaid expenditure. Now, what is prepaid expenditure? Let's understand the concept first. So, the prepaid expenditure is basically the expenses which has been paid in advance and they do not belong to the financial year which is in question, for which we are making our accounts. Now, this prepaid expenditure is basically not a liability for this year, rather you have paid in advance. So, the treatment is this, whatever, you know, account it belongs to, if we have given the item, for example, let's just refer to the screen at this moment. Your screen is showing, you know, extracts of trial balance. It is showing in the debit side we have salaries 10,000 and rent 5,000, right? And in the additional information, it shows that salaries for the month of January of 2000 has been paid in advance, and rent for 1,000 rupees has also been paid in advance. Now the question is, how would we be showing this in our books of accounts? So here in the last example, the salaries were yet to be paid, right? Here we have paid something in advance. Somebody asked you, your employee wanted some money in advance. They have to go for some marriage, they have some, you know, financial limitation at home, some kind of requirement. Under any condition, any employee could be given in salary in advance, right? Now this is not an expenditure for this financial year, but you have actually incurred it. Your cash has reduced by that amount, right? So as per the rule, we have not to entertain this amount because this does not belong to this financial year. This is what we talked last day, that as per the accounting concept, we have to match revenue with the expenditure of the same year, not with the expenditure of next year. This salary for which the guy will be serving you next year, you have paid in advance, is not expenditure of this year. So if we will match this salary of 2000 which we have paid in advance with this year revenue, our profits or loss would be a wrong value. This will be an incorrect figure. So to correct that, to ensure that our profit or loss are shown at the correct, you know, value, we will be adjusting, or we will be making an adjustment for this variable, which is advance payments or prepaid expenditure. So what are we going to do with this? We are going to reduce the specific expenditure account. Here we have two examples, salaries and rent. So we have been given 10,000 in the trial balance. This is a nominal account. We will be debiting 10,000 in the debit side of the P&L account, and so is 5,000 rent account in P&L account, second section. And out of that, we will be reducing 2,000 from salaries and 1,000 from rent account, because the actual salaries for this month are, or for this financial year, are not 10,000 but 10 minus 2, 8,000, and actual rent is 5,000 minus 1,000, 4,000, right? So we are showing the expenditure at a correct value, which actually belongs to this year, not at a, you know, exaggerated value, or at a value which doesn't belong to this year, so that our profits are at a correct value. What will be the effect? Just imagine, if we will show the salaries at 10,000 and 5,000 instead of 8 and, you know, 4,000, our profits are going to be reduced by 3,000, 2 plus 1, right? So our profits will not be showing at a correct value. Our books will be showing profits at a wrong value. So it means we are not going to show a correct picture of the operational results. To ensure that our picture, our financial position and operational results are at a correct value, we will be showing our expenditure at 8,000 and 4,000 respectively for salaries and rent. So this is the one part. As I said, we have to show it at two places. The question comes in, where we have to show it in the second part, as a second part. So in the balance sheet, we are going to show 2,000 salaries and 1,000 rent as prepaid salary and prepaid rent of 2,000 and 1,000 respectively as prepaid expenditure in the asset side, right? It means whatever has been paid in advance is shown as asset. This becomes our current asset, because you will be getting the benefit in the next month, within the next financial year. So it becomes as current assets. So prepaid expenditure is basically a fictitious asset. You know, why fictitious? Fictitious means an asset which is though shown in the balance sheet but is not having any saleable value. We cannot sell any expenditure. You know, just imagine, you have paid to your employees. Can you sell off this, and we are showing it as an asset in our books? Can you sell this 2,000 off to somebody? No. You can simply, at the most, you will be getting the benefit against 2,000. And the reason that why we are showing in the balance sheet is this, that we have yet to avail the benefit against this 2,000 and against this 1,000. Otherwise, this 2,000 and 1,000 is not your asset. It cannot be sold off. That is why we use a particular word for this, these type of assets, and that word is, you know, fictitious asset. So basically, this is a these are the examples of fictitious assets, and this is the treatment to prepaid expenditure, that is expenditure paid in advance. Now, next thing I would like to talk about is outstanding income. What is outstanding income? Now, outstanding income is, you know, reverse on adverse to the previous one, that is prepaid expenditure or prepaid income. So outstanding income is something which you have actually earned in the financial year, but you have yet to receive it. You know, you have rented off your building, but you have yet to receive the rent. You have some share, and your dividend is become due, but company has yet to pay you dividend. So it could be something like commission, it could be anything else, it could be interest on debentures. So outstanding income means income which has become due, which has been earned, belongs to one accounting period, but has not become due as such because of the due date only. Otherwise, that has become, you know, payable to you, belongs to this accounting year. So how to treat it basically? So if you refer to the slide shown on the screen at this moment, we have taken an example of, extract of the trial balance, where we have loan, 6% loan, rupees 20,000. We have 6% debentures of B Limited, 30,000 worth. We have interest on loan and interest of debenture shown in the credit side as 1,000 and 9,000. And in the additional information, we have been given that interest on loan is receivable on monthly basis and is received only up to October. And interest on debenture becomes due on 31st March and 31st September. And we close our books of accounts on 31st December. It means on 31st December, whatever is been going to be received on 31st March is actually basically after 31st September. So for 3 months, for October, November and December, you have yet to receive the interest, right? In this example, this has become due to you actually, but this has actually been earned, but as per the policy of the company of whose debenture you have, they do not pay it on 31st December, they pay it on March. It means you will actually be receiving it in the next year. So the question is, should you be considering, you have not received it. The question comes in, should you be recording this in your books of accounts or not? Yes, you should be, because you have that accounting rule of accrual concept, where we say it's not important that whether we have received this income or not, whether we have paid it or not. It should actually belong to the accounting period in question. So that is something important. So how to treat this? This interest amount, which has actually been earned in this year itself, but has not become payable to you simply because of the due date, issues of the company, you are going to show this interest by adding this amount in the interest on loan 1000 as given in the question here, in the example here, on the credit side of P&L account. So you will be showing 1000, which is given in the credit side of the, as a credit balance in the trial balance, plus whatever is due. Right, 3 months interest is 1800 for the year, and then you can multiply it by 3 by 12, you will get the value of the interest to be credited, to be added to the 1000 rupees. So your actual interest charges will be shown 1000 plus 3 months additional interest. This is the in the income statement. And how to show it in the, in the balance sheet? Since you have yet to receive it, it will be shown as an asset in the asset side of the balance sheet, only the amount of 3 months, not this 1000. 1000 will be shown only in the income statement. As I said, the item shown in the trial balance will be shown only at one place, whereas item shown outside the trial balance will be shown at two places, right? So this is how we are going to treat the outstanding income here. The next adjustment entry I would like to talk about is about the bad debts. Now, what are bad debts? Bad debts are basically the outcome of credit sales. Whenever we sell on credit, required as of date. Nowadays, to promote our sales, we don't sell always on cash. We don't get opportunity to sell always on cash. We have to sell for times on credit, and there are many businesses which are actually based on completely or purely on credit basis only. In that case, you know, there's a possibility that you may not get certain amount as being recovered out of the credit sales. So bad debts are outcome of credit sales. Now the question is how to deal with it. So bad debts could be given in the trial balance as it's been shown on the screen at this moment as a part of trial balance, and it could be given in the additional information. If it is given in only in the trial balance, then it will be debited in the profit and loss account. But if it is given outside as well, then the amount of additional bad debts will be added to the amount of bad debts. For example, here 5000 is the amount of bad debts, and additional bad debts as given number at point number 1 is 3000. So this 3000 will be added to the 5000 rupees, right? So total bad debts amount shown in the P&L account would be 8000, 5 plus 3000, right? So this is at one place. And as I said, this 3000 would be shown at the second place as well. So this 3000 will be shown in the balance sheet by deducting 3000 from the debtor's amount. In the question, in this example, in this extract, 30000 has been given as debtors. So out of this 30000, the 5000 which is already given in the trial balance, that is not going to be deducted. We assume this has been adjusted. So this 3000 of additional bad debts will be deducted from 30000. Right, and this 3000 will be added and the 5000 as well. So this is how we treat bad debts. Now the next is provision for bad debts. As we were talking on last day, that provisions are basically providing for some future expected problem or loss or possibility of loss or possibility of liability. If that is there, we provide for, we keep something aside to meet that liability or obligation. That is what the provisions are. As we are sensing that we will have some bad debts, we provide for those bad debts by creating provisions, right? In case we don't have some payments received from the debtors, so we have some funds left aside, kept aside. So how to deal with this? So this is again going to be taken as provision for bad debts is a liability. So they are created out of profits to meet the future liabilities. So they belongs to owners basically. So this additional bad debts, if they was given in the question, will be added to the bad debts, and whatever the percentage of bad debts provision is given, we are going to calculate the amount as a percentage on debtors which are good. It means debtors minus if any additional bad debts is given, we will reduce that amount, and whatever the balance is there on that balance, we will be calculating the amount of provision for bad debts, but at the rate of percentage given in the question. If it is here, it is given 10%. So the rate of creating the provision will be 10% here. It could be any percentage as per the practice, as per the possibility of the loss and all. So this is going to be added, and this provision for bad debts in balance sheet will be reduced from debtor's amount. So this is the total treatment. So again, these provisions are going to be shown at two places. So basically what I'm saying here is this: the rule that any item given outside the balance sheet is going to be shown at two places, and any item given in the trial balance, within the trial balance, would be shown at one place only. So that is what I'm trying to say. Now the next item I would like to talk about is provision for discount on debtors. What is that? You assume that yes, I will be getting my money paid back out of my credit sale, but I may still have to offer some kind of discount to encourage early cash payment, right? So that is what we call it as provision for discount on debtors. You sold something off, right? And you are expecting it to be received in 3 months time, but you encourage, you need cash, you encourage the guy, pay me off in by within 2 months, I will give you 2% discount, I will give you 5% further discount. So for promoting the early cash recovery, we create provisions, right? And that provision is basically a loss to you. You are going to get certain amount lesser than what you should have otherwise been getting, right? So this provision is known as provision for discount on debtors. But one thing here important is this: that discounts are not given to bad debts, discounts are always given to good debtors, right? So this discount is given, as I said, to good debtors, means it will be calculated as a percentage given in the question or on the situation, but on good debtors. So for calculating good debtors, we need to reduce the amount of bad debts plus any additional bad debts plus any amount of provision for bad debts, which we just discussed in the few minutes ago. So bad debts plus provision for bad debts are going to be reduced from debtors, and then whatever is left as a balance, on that amount of balance we will be calculating as a percentage for creating provision for discount on debtors. So I hope this point is clear. Though I understand that this is a little more theoretical lecture, as we are not doing a practical, but I am trying to make it as possible, practical as possible, by showing you certain examples on the slide, by sharing you figures and percentages, etc., so that you could actually correlate and figure out how to calculate, right? So if you have referred to the slide which we just talked about, if 10% provision for bad debts are considered, so we will be deducting this 10% provision for bad debts first out of 50,000, and then we will be calculating 5% provision for discount on debtors as given in this example, right? Now this amount, as I said, will be debited in the P&L account as provision for discount on debtors. Now in the balance sheet again, this amount will be reduced from debtors. So this is the double effect. As I said, anything shown out of the balance, out of the trial balance, will be shown at two places, because we have dual aspect concept. We have the accounting rule of treating the item, showing the item at two places. Under that concept, and because of that effect, we are going to show it at two places. Now the next thing is, I would like to talk about how to deal with commission. Now the commission is basically paid for promoting sales to the salesman. Now commission could be paid on two bases. One is basis as a profit after sales, and second commissions after sales, after profits, and commission before profits, before calculating profits. So if it is before and after, if it is before, then we will be calculating the percentage of commission, whatever the percentage is given, by multiplying that percentage to the amount of profits, whatever is been calculated so far. But if it is given after, then it will be percentage divided by the 100 plus the percentage. Say for example, if it is 10%, so in the first case we will calculate as 10 by 100. In the second case, we will calculate as 10 by 110, right? Now, the last transaction of adjustment entry I am going to talk is, how to deal with depreciation. There is one more, if the time permits, we will, talk about that as well. The depreciation is basically an expenditure. Whatever the percentage of depreciation of own asset is to be calculated would be given in the additional information. We will calculate that amount, and we will debit that depreciation in the P&L account, and we will reduce that amount from the asset side. So this is how we treat depreciation. So basically, I have talked about in detail all adjustment entries which we consider and treat while making balance sheet. To my understanding, no variable, no item, nothing has left to deal with while making the balance sheet. I have talked on length all the items, and I hope you have been able to understand how to make balance sheet.
Yes, Dr. Malhotra, you have gave all the essential inputs, and you have left no stone unturned, because you have given all the examples you. Through your presentation you. As thank well you. As through this lecture.
Yeah.
Thank you so very much. As you said earlier, you told our every student of ours and our viewers how to prepare balance sheet, and we hope very soon we come up with the financial statement, that is the analysis part of the financial
yeah.
statement.
Yeah.
Thank you so very much for
thank
being
so
with
much.
Us.
Thank you so much.